We have, it's good to have you here this morning, and I keep hearing comments from people that are going into lockdown mode, people that are really concerned, and so it's good to have you here this morning. I remember back when this all started, I was down in Funny River near Soldotna, and to see an empty church for the first time with nothing but a camera, that was something else. I shared with you already once, and you'll hear stories repeatedly from me as I'm getting to that age. But I had a service one time, an Easter service, which only three people came. Now let me explain. I was a baby chaplain, and the ship was being torn apart in Todd's Shipyard in Seattle. And everybody was given liberty Easter weekend that they could possibly get off the ship. But there was necessary fire watch standards, and people were standing fire watch and guards and stuff. And so I went over there, though, and we had an Easter service, and we couldn't light the candles because they had fuel hatches that were, there was one that was in the briefing room that we doubled as a chapel, and that was open, and it smelled like diesel fuel. And so we said, let's not light the candles. it was a fuel and ammo ship anyway. And we had the three there and myself, four. And I'll never, ever forget that service. And they won't either. So thank you for coming this morning. And as we begin continue this Advent season. And normally the church would be full. And it is a scary time. That's the thing. How do we live with fear? And that was as a chaplain. I was a Navy Marine Corps chaplain, and living with fear. There was three times we're told to brace for impact. Twice planes flew at us, put the missile lock on us, had anti-ship missiles. Iranian planes came straight at us, and one of our ships was blown up. And while we were over there, and how do you live with that kind of fear day to day? And as Christians, we have the answer. It's keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus. And that's something I tell all of you and remind you, not tell you, you already know this, but to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, not the news and not the virus. And we will get through this. I've heard many stories of people, family members, and others that have gotten the virus. They said it's just like the normal flu. My son said he had it, his family had it, and he said it was better because he didn't have nausea, he just had headaches. But he had the temperature and had the coughing and stuff, and it was just like a normal cold. But for others, it can be more, there can be complications and stuff, so... But anyway, keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, and that's what we're doing this morning, keeping our eyes fixed on Him as we gather together for worship. And thank you for coming. And we'll stand as we begin with our opening song.
Thank you.
This morning in the gospel, John is baptizing in the Jordan River, calling people to repent. And that's what, beginning of the service, we're reminded of our baptism, and we repent of our sins, acknowledge that we're broken, and hear again the good news that our sins are forgiven. We begin in remembrance of our own baptisms in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you for your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office, to call up our names, servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And in the stead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry, and I say, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with young. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson comes from 2 Peter verses 3, verses 8 through 14. But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is as a thousand years, and a thousand years is one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promises, some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. And then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God? Because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth, in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish, and at peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, after me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
this time I invite the children to come forward for the children's message. Good morning, good morning. Well, we have, did you guys get Advent calendars?
No.
Oh, in Sunday school?
Mm-hmm.
I've got some here. Here. These are countdowns to Christmas. They're countdowns to Christmas, and you open a little window each week, and there's a Bible verse. But when you run out of windows, guess what time it is?
Christmas.
You bet. And it goes really fast for adults, but for kids, it takes a long time for Christmas to come around, right? Today John was down there at the Jordan River, and people were going down to the temple to worship, and they crossed the Jordan River, and there's 20 miles of roads going, winding up the mountains to Jerusalem. But he was down there, and you know what he was saying? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And imagine that. And he looked kind of crazy. And he was a little crazy, like most of us pastors. But anyway, he wore a crude robe made out of camel hair. He'd picked chunks of hair off of the sticker bushes and stuff along the river and made this crude outfit out of camel hair. Had a piece of leather tied around his waist. And you know what he ate? Grasshoppers. Locusts or grasshoppers. And honey. And usually where there's honey, there's what? Bees, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you get stung every time you went to go find supper, right? But John, he had that message. He says, repent! And what does repent mean? We do that all the time, but we don't call it repenting. We call it saying, I'm sorry, right? Have you ever had to say I'm sorry before? Who hasn't had to say I'm sorry? I didn't think so. Yeah. No! What? Oh, God. I thought you were raising your hand saying, I've never had to say I'm sorry. No, God doesn't have to say he's sorry. But yeah, so there's it's saying we're sorry, and we have to say it all the time. I do too. And when we hurt people, we say something we didn't think about, didn't realize it hurt somebody, and it hurt, we say, I'm sorry. Can we say that together? I'm sorry. it doesn't get real easy to say, does it? And with something that's almost as hard to say is, I forgive you, right? Because we're mad usually when somebody says they're sorry to us. And we have to say, it's okay, you know, and I forgive you. But when we hurt other people, we're also hurting who? God, right? He's sad. Just like mom and dad get sad when we're fighting, when the kids are fighting, right? And so God he's sad when he sees us hurting each other, whether it's mean things that are said or whatever. And so when we say we're sorry to others, we also say to God, what do we say? I'm sorry. That's what we did. We do that every Sunday at the beginning of the worship service. We say, I'm sorry, God. And what God says through the pastor, what does God say through the pastor? You're forgiven. You're forgiven. And that reminder that not only do we do things to hurt others, God and others, but also that we're forgiven and loved by God. You guys can come up. I've got just some little bit of water in here, and this is right there. Just ordinary, regular water. Come on up. And back in the early church, they did is they would take the water used for baptisms, and they'd have it sitting out by the door. People coming in would dip their finger in it, and they'd make a sign of the cross on their forehead, right? And can you see the cross on my forehead? No, all you can see is water. But go ahead and do that. Just dip your finger in there and make a cross on your forehead. And it's a reminder that our sins are forgiven. That God, a reminder of our baptism where God washed our sins away. And it's not something we have to do or anything, but it's a church tradition that goes back thousands of years. And that reminder that our sins are forgiven. Jesus washed our sins away. But anyway, that saying I'm sorry, it's an important word to remember to say again and again. And we'll have to say that thousands and thousands of times during our lifetime. I know, because I've had to say that many, many times. I'm sorry. And I've also had to say I forgive you to people that have hurt me. And it's a good exercise. And God loves us and forgives us, calls us to be his children, and that's what gives us joy in our hearts, right? When we know that we're, our sins are forgiven and that God loves us. Here, Thomas, go ahead and hand those out. Well, actually, wait just a second. We're going to have a prayer first. Let's pray. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For washing away
my sins.
May I forgive others
as you have forgiven me.
Amen.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for coming up.
Peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. from the gospel just read, John appeared baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all of Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. You know, Advent is a time of preparation. The Advent season is the month leading up to Christ's birth. But it's also a time of preparation at home. Things are in full gear this time of year. Putting up trees, baking, cooking, getting presents to send to friends and relatives, preparing for get-togethers. A lot of things going on. But how do we as Christians prepare to celebrate the incarnation? The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Well, you know, this time of year, it's a, you know that there's a lot of depression and depression is not just caused by lack of sunlight. Depression, in the simple clinical definition, is it's anger internalized. So as a counselor, you want to find out what is the person angry about? There's anger inside. Why would people be angry? Well, there's real and perceived hurts that they're dealing with. We all have our issues. All of us. And some of them stem from childhood. Hurts and perceived and real from our childhood. Things parents said to us or didn't say to us. Things they did or didn't do for us. And then throughout life, relationships are messy. They involve hurt and pain, heartache and grief. And as time goes on, those difficult situations build up. The hurts build up. There's anger that builds up. When we stuff it down and internalize it, we get seasonal affective disorder. Or cabin fever, depression. Yeah, part of that's caused by vitamin D deficiency and there is the lack of sunlight, but it aggravates what's already there. Some of these hurts, you know what I'm talking about, because we all have them. Real and perceived hurts over the years, and they build up, and we stew about them, and we know we haven't let go because they keep popping up in our minds. John came to restore relationships, and it began with repentance. Restoring our relationship with God because we've caused him a lot of pain and hurt. The first step in restoring that relationship is repenting. Acknowledging those hurts. And it's very freeing when we do that. It lets go of all that stuff inside. As we give it to God, as we confess our sins, and then also hear those words, I forgive you and I love you. Baptism of repentance was a common practice clear up to the first century in Judaism. They had baptismals in the synagogues. It was done away with after the first century because it was too confusing with Christian baptism. The practice was confessing your sins as you were washed, usually involving the 38th Psalm, Psalm 51. Cleanse me with hyssop, O Lord, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. You know, these psalms of confession, they're washed. Priests did this as they began their service in the temple. People would do this
not just once in a lifetime, but it was a regular occurrence in the synagogue, this ritual washing. That's what baptismos means, the Greek word. It wasn't ever translated because the Baptists had made an appearance by the time King James said, the scribes were working on the King James translation. They said, it's a little too controversial. Let's not translate this word. We'll just add English letters to it so it won't be controversial. But it means a ritual washing. But here, John called people to repent, do an about face. In fact, this is the first translation of the Bible from Greek into Latin. There's Jerome translated it. And he messed up on this word. In other words, he did it by himself. It would have been better to have a team to work with, but he was translating it into the Latin. And this Greek word, metanoia, which means to do an about face, it was actually a Greek military term that when a sergeant barked, metanoia, the guys would spin around and start marching in the opposite direction. It was also a change of mind. Well, Jerome translated it, do acts of penance. Well, you can imagine when people read the Bible and it says do acts of penance, well, clear up to Luther's day. They were doing acts of penance. You do acts of penance to appease God. Luther knew Greek. it's about a change of mind. Yeah, also a change of direction, doing an about face. It's acknowledging our brokenness and allowing God to begin the healing process. You know, it's acknowledging that we've caused God and others hurt and pain. In fact, there's a German word when you say I'm sorry, you say es tut mir leid. It means it does me pain. That's how you say I'm sorry in German. It does me pain. What I did to you causes me pain. And I think it captures the substance of that a little bit better. I'm starting to feel pain because of what I did to you. We realize what we've done to God and others, it does bring about pain. It sinks into us and we repent. It's interesting, the two different responses, though. The Pharisees that come out to see John, and it must have been quite a show. This guy yelling out, repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Long beard, long hair, the camel hair robe he wore with a chunk of leather tied around his waist. People were coming in droves. The Pharisees would come and watch him and observe what was going on. In fact, John was the son of a high priest. He should have been the high priest. He was the legitimate high priest. He should have been in the temple serving as high priest. He was ousted. Somebody else had taken it over. Another family, Caiaphas and his son-in-law. They weren't the legitimate high priest. It should have been John. But here these Pharisees came out, and they were observing from a distance, and they quite a show for them. For them, they didn't need to repent. They were perfect. No need to repent. You know, there's a lot of people out there today that don't see. In fact, that's the sign of somebody that really has issues, when they don't think they have any. Those are the scariest ones. We all have issues. We're all broken. And it was the tax collectors and the sinners that came out to John, and they realized their brokenness and acknowledged that, confessing their sins and having this ritual washing, this baptism of repentance. You know, we remember our baptism daily. Remembering where God washed away our sins, clothed us with his righteousness,
called us to be his children. Daily we live in that baptism by repenting to God and to others. We have opportunities every day to say, I'm sorry, and I forgive you. Daily forgiveness. That's an important part, remembering that God has forgiven us. Letting go of the hurts we've caused God and others. We like to hold on to. No, we've given them to God when we repent. Never, and that's the one thing that God forgets is our sins. God forgets not to be remembered anymore. And so this holiday season, as we prepare for his coming, and we're busy with all those other preparations at home, maybe a little acknowledging hurts that we've caused family and friends this time of year. Maybe a phone call or a text is in order. Restoring some of these relationships. As we realize our brokenness, we also realize how we've caused hurt and pain to others. Acknowledging that. Restoring some of these broken relationships, because it can be a stressful time of year. The holidays are very stressful, getting together with people that we have issues with. How about letting go of those issues? Giving them to God. That's something, you know, I tell people, I have a hard time with this too. How do you forgive and let go of hurts that someone's caused you? We're not acknowledging that it's okay and they might not have repented. Or acknowledge that they've done something to hurt us, but we're giving it to God. Saying, God, I don't want to carry this around anymore. I'm going to give this to you. If they repent, you forgive them as you've forgiven me, because I certainly don't deserve your love and your forgiveness. But if they don't, you deal with it, Lord, because I'm tired of carrying this around. And how freeing that is to let go of these past perceived and real hurts with others, and how it restores relationships among family, and friends, and loved ones. May God continue to lead us to acknowledge our brokenness, but at the same time see how he's made us whole. Washed our sins away, clothed us with his righteousness. And as we grasp his love and his forgiveness, may we be more loving and forgiving to those around us. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, life everlasting. Amen. We rise for prayer. Merciful God, in this season of Advent, prepare the hearts of your whole church with true repentance, that we may be restored in faith and revived by your gift of life and salvation. Bless the preaching of your word, that your Son, Jesus, may be proclaimed boldly as the only Savior. Guide all who serve as leaders in the church, that they may constantly follow in the steps of Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Enlighten the minds and understanding of all leaders of nations, that they may clear pathways for your merciful rule in the hearts of all people. Grant your blessing, especially upon our nation and its leaders, that we may walk in your ways according to your truth. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
In the wilderness of our struggle with sin, sickness, separation, and death, come to each of us, Lord Jesus, with deliverance, healing, reconciliation, and life. For all who are caught up in or devastated by conflict, for all who suffer illness, especially, Lord, we lift up to you those suffering in our midst. Lift up to Bob, Donna, and Melody. We have the tested positive for COVID-19 and are recovering at home. For Doug Campbell, as he continues to
Madeline Lear's brother-in-law, Jim Brass, in hospice, and Heather Cook's family in need of her sister and her husband, Eric, in need of healing in their relationship. Megan S. and Mabel Lopez. Christy Braun's mom, June. Harry Gratz, John Hoffman, and Eric Johnson. In need of your healing touch. Megan B. And others, O Lord, that we lift up in our hearts at this time. Lord, you are the great physician of soul and body, and we ask for healing according to your gracious will. Lord, we also ask for your peace and your presence, Delaney Jensen and her family as they mourn the loss of Jill. For Ellen Axner's family, whose aunt and uncle passed away. Roxanne Lesneski and his brother Randy passed away. Lord, we just ask for your peace and your presence in this difficult time as these families mourn the loss of loved ones. May they also find comfort in the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting, your promise, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
With the cries of Hosanna, we welcome you, Lord Jesus, as you come to us in your body and blood. Blessed are you, Lord. Prepare our hearts with true repentance and faith that we may receive you with all joy and confidence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And we pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Peace of the Lord be with you all. We rise. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed our faith through the body and blood of your only Son. Strengthen our faith each day by your word and spirit, and help us to love you with our whole hearts, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Just a Jill Jensen was called home rather suddenly, wasn't expected, last Sunday, and so Delaine and the family are mourning her loss and also rejoicing that the Lord took her home to heaven at the same time. But as they're planning that we'll have a funeral service on Tuesday at 2:00, and they want to keep it small, but they don't want to exclude people either, you know. So she said, basically, if you consider yourself family, and I know there's the church family, she says, you're welcome to come to Jill's funeral, but they just don't come just for their sake, she said. But anyway, she's trying to be, keep it small, but also not exclude anybody. So if you did, and so it's at 2:00 on Tuesday, and and it's always, you know, the mourning the loss of a loved one in Christ, and yet at the same time rejoicing in the good news of the resurrection. It's like the awfulness of Good Friday combined with Easter morning. I always tell people that. It's like combining the two services, Good Friday and Easter morning for us as believers. So anyway, just wanted to let everybody know about the funeral on Tuesday. And but as we go in peace and serve God and your neighbor.
Thanks be to God.